Today we are going to look at the MSI RTX 3080 Ti Suprim X, and this is a GPU that I have personally purchased at a very high price, so I am of course not going to say bad things about it because I have just invested too much in it. But the Suprim X series of cards is something that I found to be genuinely interesting because it is definitely a much more tasteful approach compared to the previous premium lineup by MSI. Hey guys, I am Siddharth, and let's pretend that the card is still in the box and that you have not seen this yet, so the unboxing can be more exciting. And we are of course going to talk about its temperatures and the performance, and I am also going to show you how much I was able to undervolt it, because wow, there are some massive improvements. So beginning with the unboxing, in addition to its white color, I really like that the box opens like a briefcase instead of you needing to slide things out, which doesn't feel very premium. Inside it, you get the usual papers like the thank you card and a manual. Then you get a thick mouse pad, which is actually surprisingly usable and looks nice. Then getting further into the box, you will find a very high quality metal anti-GPU sag support, and MSI should really sell this separately. Then finally getting to our GPU, we obviously have a thick boy here, and this is an almost triple slot card measuring 33.6 cm in length, which is even larger than my already massive 2080 Ti Gaming X Trio, and the card is also quite heavy at 2 kg. While we all can appreciate monster looking cards, I think that this is the limit of size that GPUs should be made of. Just look at how far the cooler extends from the PCB. The Suprim X has MSI's new Torx 4.0 fans, and the blades on these fans are joined in pairs, so that should make them stronger, and these also stop below 60 degrees for some nice passive cooling. We also have an RGB zone on the backplate, which has this very cool crystal MSI logo, and this card also features dual BIOS with a silent and a gaming mode, but I think that most people should just use the gaming BIOS. The central part of the shroud is made of this metal piece with this really great gunmetal finish. And I have to say that the finishing on all parts of this card looks super premium and really gives this a very high quality feel. At the back, we have 3 display ports along with an HDMI port, and here are the specs of the graphics card if you want to know about the number of CUDA cores or other details. So now let's look at how the card looks when you install it, and this is how it looks like installed horizontally. You can see the Suprim logo on the side light up with the RGB strip, and the lighting zone on the backplate also looks great. But of course, I bought this card to be mounted vertically in my case, and I was right about how good this was going to look in my Lian Li case. This card really looks super simple with its rectangular shape, but then the angles on its shroud and the hexagonal cutouts for fans really give this a very tasteful look. And even its size looks very appropriate in a large case like the O11 Dynamic. I also had to add the anti-sag stand because even on vertical mount, the card was sagging a little without it, but it's great to see that you can also easily use it for a vertically mounted GPU. The MSI Center software looks more polished than what MSI had earlier, and while there are plenty of modules that you can download, I only downloaded the Mystic Light and Fan Control module, and these two work as you expect. You can of course control the RGB with Mystic Light and even turn it off in different parts of the GPU. And with the fan control, you can disable the passive cooling feature on lower temperatures, and then there are monitoring tools for the GPU along with a dark mode for the app, which is pretty cool. Now the boost clock of the Suprim X version easily reaches at 1935 MHz, which is like 16% faster than the boost clock of Founders Edition, so that is a very significant jump in performance, and it should push this beyond the performance of the 3090 Founders Edition. I only benchmarked these 8 games at 4K because this is the resolution you are meant to be playing at if you are buying this GPU, and we can see that we are getting around 80fps or more even in the most demanding of AAA games. So I am really enjoying gaming at the native resolution of my G-Sync monitor, and we are also reaching more than 320fps at 4K Ultra in games like Rainbow Six Siege, which is so insane. But you already know how the 3080 Ti performs, so the question is how well does the MSI's board and cooler handle the chip? And the answer to that is that it is a pretty good performer. On its stock settings, with an ambient temperature of around 30 degrees Celsius, the card ran at around 74 to 75 degrees, which is a number that becomes impressive when you find out that the card is configured to draw up to 400 watts on stock settings, which is higher than most of the 3080 Ti's, being 50 watts higher than the Founders Edition. By the way, do excuse the lack of fancy graphs here. I didn't have the budget for that because I spent all of my money on the card, and you can subscribe to the channel with bell so we can have fancy graphs in the future. But this gets very interesting when we try to undervolt this, because at least the card that I got was able to run stable at 831 millivolts at 1920 MHz. Which is a really impressive result, and at this voltage, we observed a reduction in power consumption by around 75 to 100 watts while maintaining the same performance. And the temperature also decreased by 7 to 8 degrees if you ran the fans at same RPM. Now the card that I got seems to have a really great silicon quality, because 831 milliwatts is the best result that I have seen online. But I think that most people should be able to do around 875 millivolts, which is also going to reduce your temperatures and power consumption dramatically. But we can push this down even further, and if you are okay with reducing the clock speed by around 4%, I was also able to run my card at 793 millivolts at 1845 MHz. And this really makes the card run even cooler at 66 degrees while having almost identical performance. As for its acoustic performance, these fans go up to 3200 RPM at 100%, but you will mostly see this running at 50 to 65%, and at 50%, these are almost inaudible. But over 60%, you do start to hear them, and at stock settings, the fans will run at around 2200 RPM, which is audible if you have the case near you. But the other fans in my case definitely become a bigger source of noise. And for a cooler that is keeping this 400 watt card at 75 degrees, I have to say that the acoustic performance of this card is really great. This was all tested in the gaming mode of the card, and I didn't even try the silent mode, because even in the gaming mode, I didn't find the noise to be bothersome at all. So in conclusion, the 3080 Ti Suprim X is a pretty good performer. The main reason for buying this card for me was its aesthetics in my Lianli case, but of course I wouldn't go for this if I wasn't sure that MSI has made a well-performing card. You are getting slightly higher performance than other AIB cards with a higher power draw at good temperatures, but you can undervolt this to get better temperatures, and even at stock settings, the thermal and acoustic performance is nice. Now the pricing of these GPUs is still really high, and even now, finding these in stock is not easy. And you can also expect to pay around 1.7 to 2 lakh rupees for this, if you can find it in stock. We can talk all day about how bad the situation is currently, and I could tell you to just wait for the situation to improve, but what it boils down to is whether you need a GPU now or not. If you don't need to upgrade now, then you should obviously not do it, but maybe you are in a situation like me and you need to build a PC now. Then the situation that you would face would be that the 3080 is also difficult to find in stock, and if someone has it, then they might actually try to sell it for 2 lakh rupees. So in the current market, the price difference between the 3080 and 3080 Ti isn't as big as it should have been, and if you try to find a 3090, then you might have to pay close to 3 lakh rupees for that. So in that situation, the 3080 Ti can become a viable alternative. If this card didn't exist, then I would have either bought an overpriced 3080 or I would have spent 3 lakh rupees on a 3090. So getting almost the same performance as a 3090 for a lot less money obviously becomes more sensible, and by that logic, the 3080 Ti is a surprisingly logical purchase if you cannot wait. Do remember that the global chip shortage can last for a year or more, so it's not a wait of a month or two that you will have to go through. The reference prices really don't mean anything, so MSI and all other board partners have to take a hit with being unable to price their GPUs lower than this in the current market. So while I can recommend this card as a product in isolation, as it delivers on the things that I was looking for, whether spending whatever amount you can find it for is worth it or not is something that you will have to decide. For those interested in the performance of my new PC, you have seen the gaming results, but the 5950X is also the best mainstream desktop CPU, so getting a score of more than 10,000 in Cinebench R20 is of course really awesome, and all of the 32 threads do get utilized in more situations than I was expecting. And that will be it for this video. Do let me know what you think about this card in the comment section below, and I'll have links to buy this if I can find those in the video description. Do give this video a thumbs up if you liked it, or a thumbs down if you disliked it. Subscribe with bell, follow me on socials, check out my Amazon store. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.